It's good to see you this morning. Amen. All right, if you have your outline, this is what I'm going to start this year. Our theme for this year is advance. 2016 was more and better, but that was 2016. This year we have to advance. So get your outline. If you have your Bibles, you can go to Zechariah chapter 10, verse 12. There's a specific verse that we are going to use for this series. This series, we're going to do it all the month of January, I think, till February, until we start doing talking about building for the future. But this year, our theme for New Life is Advance 2017. Tell the person next to you, you got to advance, man. You can't stay where you're at. You can't stay where you're at. Y'all ready to advance this year? Yes. All right, let us pray and just follow me in your outline. Father, you are awesome. You are not only the God of innovation, you are the God that always is advancing. And I pray that this year, Father, that you would help us shatter every barrier of limitation, every barrier of every wall that has stopped us or hindered us from advancing in your will, in your dream, in your purpose for our lives. Thank you for everyone that is here, and I pray that all of us will leave out of here, God, challenged, encouraged to advance to what you have for us in 2017. And everyone said, Amen. So this is our theme for 2017, advance. Now, what is advance? The dictionary says that advance is to move forward. Advance is to improve. Advance is to progress, and advance is to go further. So as your pastor, I believe that God wants New Life in 2017 to advance. Amen. This means God wants us to go forward. Yes. Why go forward? Because if you don't go forward, you're stagnant and you're going backwards. And as Christians, we are not called to be stagnant, to live comfortable lives. Many of us for years have lived in a comfort zone. And God wants you to move forward, because if you don't move forward, you're going backwards. God wants us to improve, because God is a God of improvement. Now, why should we advance this year? I believe that we need to advance because God has so much more for us. I don't believe that God is through with you, and I don't believe God is through with me, and I don't believe we have even experienced half of what God wants us to experience as a church. God has so much more. Why advance? Because not advancing is going backwards. Why advance? Because God is the God of innovation. How is it possible that Apple is advancing every year and New Life does not advance? Why is it possible that Microsoft is talking about innovating and advancing, and we're the people of God are the same year after year after year? Some of us have been the same for the past 10, 15 years. The only thing that's different is the clothes that you're wearing this morning. But your thinking has not changed. There are paradigms in our minds that must be shattered, because God is the God of advancement. God is the God of innovation. Amen. Now, this is the bottom line. If you don't advance, if I don't advance, our church does not advance. The church cannot advance if the people that make New Life their church does not advance. So we must advance. Now, this morning, I'm going to teach you what we must do to advance this year. Now, if we are going to advance, we have to learn to demolish every paradigm, every stronghold that's been holding us back. 3 years ago, my wife and I went to China, not because we were Chinese. Well, the truth is this. We arrived in Beijing, and our flight from Houston to Beijing, I think it was 16 hours. They picked us up at the airport. We were on a tour. And immediately from our airport, they took us to the main plaza, the main square in China, Tiananmen Square. And there was literally 800,000 Chinese that had come from everywhere. They had never visited that square there. So our guide told us to please stick with him, because we were going to cross the street. I think there was about 40 or 50 in our group, and only 20 or 25 of us crossed the street to the plaza, to the square. The other half stayed behind, and the first ones that crossed the street, my wife, the people that were with us, and our guide looked over at my wife and began to speak to her in Chinese. And what he was saying was, "Ma'am, I'm sorry. You're not part of our group. This is some Americans that have paid, and you need to get out of our group." I don't understand Chinese, but I could understand his body language towards my wife. So Bruce Lee came. No, not really. So I said, "Excuse me, that's my wife. What are you saying?" He said, "Oh, I'm sorry. I thought she was just another Chinese." So we went to the Wall of China. We went to the Wall of China. And when they take you to the Wall of China, you're able to walk. If you give me the Wall of China, it's up there, the Wall of China. They tell you, "We're going to give you an hour and a half, and you can go as far as you want to up to the wall." Since I'm not Chinese, I didn't go an hour and a half. Because if you ever been to the Wall of China, the steps were not made like most of these steps that we have. Some of them were long, some of them were short. And the higher you go up and you haven't walked, your knees are going to buckle, your breath. So I just went like 10, 15 minutes. I'd rather see the Wall of China from here. Now, the truth is that the Wall of China was made to protect from invasions. And then in Jerusalem, the only wall that is still standing that protected or that was part of the temple is where today, if you go to Jerusalem, years ago we went to Jerusalem, and you see that partition. On one side, the women go to one side to pray. The other was the men go to pray. But on Friday evening, when the Sabbath hits in, all the Jews, or most of the Jews, go to the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. And that wall reminds them of the temple that existed. And that wall reminds them that God is still the God of Israel. God is the God of the Jews. God is our God. And if God could hear their prayers, and they go to pray, because this wall not only reminds them of the old temple, but it reminds them, and you can put, if you go to Jerusalem, you can put little petitions. The walls are full of paper where people have placed their prayer, their requests there, because like the Wall of China was meant for protection, this wall was meant to erect the temple of God and to remind the people that God was God in Jerusalem and that God still answers prayer. Amen. The month of May, some of the guys that work with us, we went to Seattle. And when you go to Seattle, there's a wall there, and it's called the Chewing Gum Wall. Milton and Jawan went. We walked by there, and I said, "Guys," because I saw one of them got to get a gum. It was me. So if you go to Seattle, you see this, you go through a small alley, and you see this wall, and it's just for entertainment. It's just for fun. There are walls for protection. There are walls that remind us to pray. There's walls just for fun. But let me show you this wall that was built in 1961. The East Germans wanted to stop the Western influence to their people. So in 1961, communist East Berlin built the Berlin Wall. And for 28 long years, this wall was a wall of separation. This wall was a wall of hindrance. This wall was a wall that kept their people enslaved to a mentality, enslaved. And this wall was a wall that limited. You see this wall here? This wall will come down sometime this week. As a matter of fact, it's coming down this today. Because in 1989, President Reagan, in one of his speeches, told Gorbachev, "Bring down this wall." And on November the 9th, 1989, people did what they could do. Families got hammers. Family got sledgehammers. They got, and the wall of Berlin came down. Now, that was in East Germany. We're living in 2017 here in America. But sadly, in our lives, in our minds, there have been walls that have limited you. There have been walls that have stopped you from advancing. And if you are going to advance, you have to bring down every wall that has limited you. You have to bring down every wall that have stopped you from becoming everything that God wants you. The walls must come down. And this is the year where every wall that has stopped you, that has limited you, the walls must come down in the name of Jesus. Now, this is what the Bible says in Zechariah chapter 10, verse 12. And this is the verse that we will use for this series. I'm going to read it once, then I want you to read it with me. And I want you not only to read it, I want you to grasp it. I want you to believe it. And God says this to Israel: I will make my people strong. And in my name, they will advance without fear. I am the God of Israel. And I promise you, this will happen. Forgive me, I'm not a political, but Obama is not promising this. The new incoming president did not make this promise. It is the God of heaven. It is the God of Israel that declared this over Israel. And I believe this is what God is declaring over us in 2017. I will make new life stronger than it's ever been. And new life will advance without fear. God says, I am the God of Israel. And then he says, I promise this will happen. Now, if we are going to advance, we must realize the problem is not with God. Because God promises that he is going to make us stronger. Now, let me tell you why we have not advanced. We have not advanced because there have been fears in our life that have stopped us from advancing. But God says, this year, not only am I going to make my people strong, but in my name, they will advance without fear. And then God says this: I am the God of Israel. When Zechariah is declaring, or the prophet Zechariah is writing, and he inserts this three or four words, I am the God of Israel, five words, I am the God of Israel. He is referring, first of all, to the people of Israel. But he's also referring to Jacob, because Jacob was Israel. So let me quickly tell you what God is saying. See, for over 400 years, the people of God, Israel, were slaves in Egypt for over 400 years. For over 400 years, the pharaohs had enslaved God's people, Israel. But when God made them stronger, and when with God's power they advanced, God used Moses, and the walls, the slavery, the limitations, the things that for years the Egyptians had used to enslave, to stop Israel from going to the promised land, finally God raised up Moses. And because God is the God of advancement, and because God is the God of more, and because God has promises, and because God is able, God brought Israel out of slavery over 400 years. And what God is saying, if I could do it with Israel, I am going to do it with you, because I am the God of Israel. I promise this will happen. But Zechariah is not only referring to the people of Israel, he's referring to an individual named Israel. Do you remember there was two twins that were born? One of them was Esau and the other was named Jacob. And Jacob only advanced because he was a conniver, he was a deceiver. And many of us, that's what we've done through life. We've connived, we've deceived, we've lied. How old are you? I'm 40. 14. How old are you? Listen, you cannot advance if you lie on your income taxes. Because they're going to come back and get you one day. You cannot advance if you're lying to your wife. Because what you sow is what you're going to reap. To you kids, you cannot advance if you don't honor your mom and dad. Because God says, honor mom and dad, and I will give you a long life. Y'all didn't hear that. You cannot advance as a student if you don't show up to class. You cannot advance if you don't do your homework, if you don't prepare for your test. How many of you would this year want a raise in your salary? You cannot advance if you don't have a better attitude. You got to show up to work. You got to leave late. Well, I'm going to pay me overtime. Well, listen, if you honor God and if you honor your boss, God will see and God will bring you the reward. But God is referring, Zechariah is referring to an individual named Jacob. You remember the story of Jacob? His father was going to give the blessing to Esau, to the firstborn. And his mom said, let's deceive your father. And they killed a goat. They placed like hair, because he was not hairy. His brother was hairy. I could have played Jacob. And Israel was going blind, or his father was going blind. His father was going blind, Esau. And when he touched him, he says, you sound, but I feel you. And he says, Dad, I am Esau. And his father blessed him. And he had to run because his brother was going to kill him. And when he goes to Laban, his uncle eventually became his father-in-law. You see his life. He deceived. And when he was coming back, the Bible says that one night he had an encounter with the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord, when he appears to Jacob, says this, what is your name? And Jacob said, my name is Jacob. And the angel said, you've said the truth. Because Jacob means supplanter, means deceiver. And the angel said, that's true, your name is Jacob. Because you have deceived all your life. But tonight, because you have fought with me, I'm going to change your name and you will no longer be Jacob. You will meet your name from this day on will be Israel, because today you become a prince with God. And the truth is that there are things in your life that have stopped you. But God, only God, can make you the person that you can be and take you to levels that you've never been, do for you what you have never been able to do, because that's what God did for Israel. So what God is saying, not only did I do it for a nation, I did it for one specific person. What God is saying, I'm not only interested in new life, I am interested in each and every one of you individually. Where you have not advanced, where you have not progressed, if I did it for Israel, I promise I will do it for you. Because my people will be stronger and they will advance without fear. He says, I am the God of Israel and I promise this will happen. So let me tell you quickly three things that we must do if we are going to advance. Number one, if we are going to advance, we have to demolish strongholds. We have to demolish those walls that have hindered, that have stopped you, that have stopped me, that have hindered me. And all of us have faced walls of limitations. All of us face walls, strongholds. Now, let me explain to you what a stronghold is. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 and 5, Paul writes this and he says, for though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. In other words, we are in the world, but our battle, these strongholds, you cannot overcome on your own. Verse 4 says this, the weapons we fight with are not weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. Then he explains where those strongholds develop, where they form. In verse 5 he says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets up itself against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. So Paul is saying this. The battle that we fight with is going on in your mind. The strongholds, your biggest battle is in your mind. The biggest battle, it's what's going raging inside of you. And Paul says, we demolish arguments. And we demolish every pretension that self itself sets up itself against the knowledge of God. So in your eye line, this is what a stronghold is. A stronghold is a fortress. It's a prison. It's a barrier. A wall placed to stop you from conquering. A wall, a mindset that stops you from advancing. A stronghold, its purpose is to limit you, is to hinder you from advancing. A stronghold is an argument, and this is what it is. It's false thinking, it's wrong thinking. It creates a barrier in your mind. Your greatest struggles are in your mind. Now, this is what a stronghold is. The bottom line, this is what it is. A stronghold is anything that exalts itself in our minds, pretending to be bigger and to be more powerful than our God. Let me repeat that. A stronghold is a wall, is a barrier in your mind that develops, that forms, and it pretends, it thinks that it's bigger and then it's more powerful than our God. So in your life, every limitation, every wall that you face, it raises up to make you believe that your problem is bigger than God. Than your situation in your family. You will never advance because you were born in this family, because of this addiction, because this problem in your life. That's a lie of the devil. If God says that he's going to make you stronger and this is the year you're going to advance, the walls are going to come down. Addictions are going to come down. Things that have stopped you. Because this is the truth. Even if you were born poor, God is not poor. Even if you're addicted to marijuana, God knows how to break strongholds of marijuana. He did it for me. He will do it for you. Even if you have not been able to buy a house, last year I went to sign with a family that for 20 years they wanted to buy a house, but they couldn't buy a house. And I was a witness that they were signing their house and they were crying because for 20 years we couldn't buy a house. Some of you don't believe that God can give you the money to send your kids to university. God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than what we ask and more than what we think. Let me say that. Paul says in Ephesians that God is able to do exceedingly more than what we ask and more than what you think. So it's my thinking, it's not the devil, it's my thinking, it's things in my mind that have hindered me from going farther in God. But this year, your thinking is going to be renewed by the Word of God. This year, you're going to advance, you're going to become better. Only half of you believe it. Now, let me show you, point number two, how these strongholds are formed. Let me show you how these strongholds are formed. How they are erected, how they build it, how they become part of your mind. Number one, strongholds are erected in your life because of sin. Sin will always stop you. Sin will always enslave you. Sin will always bind you. And sin will always be a barrier between you and God. Okay? Now, what is the solution of sin? The blood of Jesus, Jesus Christ. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But John the Baptist says that Jesus is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Now, some of us believe that sin is killing and that yet it's true. But this is the truth. Sin develops in your mind when you're wrong thinking. Let me give you an example. I've already told you that before I came to Christ, I used to steal. The last thing I stole was a watch from my aunt. Don't worry, I don't do that no more. So do you know that sin is premeditated? What is premeditated? You saw this guy that landed in Florida, and he killed these five people, wounded eight people. He might be struggling with mental issues. That could be a fact. But the thing, he meditated, I'm going to fly from Alaska. I'm going to arrive in Florida. I'm going to put my gun in the suitcase. And when I get out of the airport, when I get out of the plane, I'm going to go to my suitcase. I'm going to load my gun. All of that was premeditated. And every sin that you and I have committed is premeditated. When I was going to steal the watch, I began to say, my God, I need that watch because I need more marijuana. And I'm going to see how when my aunt is not at home, when my aunt is not looking, it was my aunt's watch. So I premeditated. I say, okay. And my aunt was not watching. And suddenly I put that watch by it. Somehow, miraculously, it got in my pocket. No, it didn't. I thought about it. I looked at the watch. I grabbed the watch. And that's what sin is. Sin is when you touch what you're not supposed to touch, when you see what you're not supposed to see, when you do what you're not supposed to do. And that sin will always enslave you and take you further than what you thought. But I've got good news. You don't have to be enslaved to sin. You don't have to let sin control you. Instead of sin being a barrier, let the grace of God forgive you. Let the forgiveness of God raise you up, because that's what grace is. Where sin abounds, grace overabounds. And what sin stops you and sin hinders you, the grace of God picks you up and helps you to go to levels that you've never been. The only reason I'm on this platform is because of grace of God. Broke the sin, the addictions over my life, transformed me. And the only reason you're born again is because the blood of Jesus, the forgiveness of God, delivers you. So you don't have to live in sin. You can live by the word of God. But sin will always be that super glue that begins to stick more things in your mind. And then a stronghold are also built because spirit of condemnation. Spirit of condemnation is God forgave you whatever you did. If you are born again, if you ask God for forgiveness for something, I'm just going to give you an example. I asked God, I remember that when God saved me, I stole the watch in July of 1982. And in August of 1982, God saved me, and I still had the watch, and I didn't need the watch no more because I didn't need marijuana no more. So God tells me, return that watch. And I said, God, what is my mama going to say? So I went in front of my aunt. My mom was there, and I said, Tia, I'm sorry to tell you, but a month ago, here it is. Here's your watch. And my mama goes, That's all I'm going to tell you what you did. I'm not going to tell you the rest. Now, listen. Okay. That was 34 years ago. When I asked God forgiveness and when I returned the watch, I dealt with it. God dealt with it. I don't have to. When I see my aunt, I hug her. She hugs me. She doesn't come here. My aunt never reminds me of what I did 34 years ago. My mom does not remind me of what I did 34 years ago. See, the devil will always use something from your past to condemn you what you're doing today. And the Bible says that if you have been forgiven, you are no longer under a spirit of condemnation. So many of us are living with a spirit of guilt, with a spirit of shame of what you did in your past. And that's what's stopping you. Those are the walls. Okay, you did it years ago, but you're not. Look, I always say this. I am not what I'm supposed to be yet, but I'm no longer what I was. I've been forgiven. You've been forgiven. God forgave you something you did. If you did something in January 2016 and you asked God forgiveness, God already forgave you. Why are you trying to live what you did? God already don't live under spirit of condemnation. And then some of us have this spirit of, I'm not worthy to receive this from God. And then a stronghold is an argument, it's false thinking. And then most of our strongholds are formed by the way we were raised in our upbringing. Now, I'm going to tell you two of my strongest, two of the things that I dealt with the most in my life. I'm 50 years old, and I dealt with the two strongest strongholds that God had to help me to demolish were this. Number one, the spirit of poverty. Now, I don't believe that I'm going to be a millionaire. If God wants to, that's not my ultimate goal in life, to be a millionaire. But I do believe that when God saves you, God will bless you to live better. Yeah, yeah, yeah. My money does not go to drugs. My money goes to God's kingdom and to my family and to bless others. Amen. Okay? So before you, okay, here he goes. Pastor's going to talk about money. Now listen, I was born with a spirit of poverty. That spirit of poverty makes you think that you can't get ahead. That you don't deserve this new raise. I remember when I was going to marry my wife, that spirit of poverty is not only formed in our minds when we're children, or some of you weren't raised poor. Some of you were raised a little bit more affluent. And some of you, those of us that were born in poverty, it's a spirit of poverty. For those of you that were a little bit more affluent, it's a spirit of pride. Makes you believe that what you have because your parents gave it to you and you're gone in life and you live here, that's another spirit. It's another stronghold. Yeah. So I dealt with the spirit of poverty, and then I dealt very long time with the spirit of I'm not worthy. I still remember when I started dating my wife. I felt unworthy that she was going to be my girlfriend or she's going to be my wife. I still remember the first time we bought our home. I didn't feel worthy of living in this home. As the church was growing, I didn't feel worthy that I should be the pastor of New Life. So my wife set me down. I remember the day my wife spoke to me and she said this: if you do not change your way of thinking, our family will never advance. So like a typical Hispanic, I said, what do you mean? What are you trying to say? And this is what she said. If you don't change your way of thinking, you never change your way of living. Because in my vocabulary were these words: we can't and we don't have. We don't have and we can't. We can't and we don't have. We don't have and we don't can't. I could have been a rapper. My wife would say, let's do this. Because of my poverty mentality, we can't. Even if we had it, we can't. So my wife said this, because I used to do this. Check this out. When we came to Galveston 25 years ago, the church had a parsonage right in front of that parking lot, and we lived there. We had two houses there. And we gave them to a person that lives around the island, and they moved them on 35th Street. So when my colleagues, some pastors, came to preach at our church, and they would ask me, well, how did you start and what did you do? I would always immediately take them to that house. The person that we gave them to 15 years ago, he has not done nada con las casas, with the houses. They're still there. So I would give them the tour of those houses. They're in poor conditions. They're small. And then one day, I happened to commit the mistake of giving the tour to a friend of mine, and my wife is in the back. She didn't say nothing. Now, this is the truth. I'm going to be honest. At first, I thought, she's demanding. She wants more. But this is the truth. After I dropped off the pastor at the hotel, we went home, and she says, I don't want you ever again to go to those houses. She said, what do you mean? I got to remember where I come from. She said, that's not the problem. She said, instead of taking them to see where we were, take them to see where we're going. I said, what do you mean? Instead, even if you don't buy me that house, take them to see what one day you believe, what I believe that God can give us. So I no longer go back to that house. When my friends come, I take them to those big condominiums. Even if I don't live in that condominium, I'm dreaming that I'm going to go to a better place. Now listen, now then she said this. Because if you don't advance, our family won't advance, and the church will not. You're the head. You're the pastor. Yes, yes. If you don't change your way of thinking, if you don't change the way of living, if you don't change the way of talking, our kids will not change, and the church will not change. I say, okay, girl, I love you. Pray for me. Now, why am I opening up my heart? Why am I opening up my heart? Because the same struggles that I had, I have seen so many of you being in the same. Listen to this. Even if you don't go from A to C in 2017, but you should no longer be an A, go to B. If you're in B, go to C. Let me use the analogy of baseball. Some of you have been on the bench for too long. Get up and go to first base. You've been in first base for the past 20 years. Go to second base. When is the year you're going to make a run? When is the year you're going to get a home run? This is the year we must advance. This is the year you have to think bigger. You have to pray bigger. You have to believe bigger. You have to praise bigger. This is the year. Okay, I already know that your mama left you when you were 60 years old. I'm not making fun of you. What I'm trying to tell you is that many of us live with a victim's mentality. You're no longer a victim. Okay, my father divorced my mom when I was a month old. I'm 50 years old. Why do I have to go over and over that my parents divorced? Okay, my dad was a heroin addict. Okay, the church was small. Okay, we lived here. But look what God has done. Look what God has done. So those mindsets, those strongholds in our mind, this is the year they have to come down. They have to come down. Point number three, let me conclude. How are these mindsets, how are these walls, how are these strongholds demolished? How? Are you ready to demolish those strongholds in your mind this year? Are you ready to advance? In the balcony, are y'all ready to advance? Well, next Sunday, sit down here. Are y'all ready to advance? Next Sunday, arrive early. Are you ready to advance? Praise God like never before. Worship God like never before. Get excited. Get passionate. Okay, only three persons on the balcony. Now, I'm not making fun of y'all. Y'all can sit up there. That's all right. Y'all are cool. Y'all are closer to Jesus. It's not where you sit. Is the attitude of your heart. The Bible says, enter his courts with thanksgiving. Come, enter his gates with thanksgiving, Thomas courts with praise. So let me quickly give you how to break those strongholds. How to break those strongholds. The first way that those strongholds are broken down is by the word of God. It's through the word of God. The Bible says this. I'm going to read it once and then you'll read it with me. Jeremiah 23:29. It's not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks a rock in pieces. God says my word is like fire. But not only is my word like fire, my word is like a hammer that breaks rock into pieces. You know what the original says? The original says my word is powerful enough to bring down every wall. Now, not only is the word of God one of the ways that we bring down strongholds, also we must say prayers of faith. James says, you have not because you ask not. And when you ask, you're asking for the wrong reasons. But if you ask for the right, if you ask with the right motives, God save my husband. not because you want to control him, but because he needs salvation in his life. God, change the heart of my children. Change the heart of my children. God, change my financial situation. Instead of saying, no, my children will always be enslaved. My children will never serve God. You've got to pray, God, you are the God of Israel. You are the God of the impossible. If you set Israel free from slavery, you can set my children free also. You can save my husband. You've got to say prayers of faith. You can't, excuse me, because I've said those prayers. We can no longer pray church's chicken prayers. You know what church's chicken's prayer is? It's in churches where they have chicken. In church, we don't have no chickens. Church's chicken, in church, we don't have no chicken. What do you mean, Pastor? Stop praying winkling. Stop praying. You're not asking me. You're asking God. You're praying to the God of the universe. There is nothing impossible. He does everything exceedingly, abundantly, more than what we think, and more. Pray bigger prayers. Dream bigger than you've ever dreamed. So you got to say prayers of faith. Now you got to give like with faith like never before. This is where everybody's faith goes down. Last year, for the past 5 years, we've had a family from El Salvador. And he told us this last Sunday. He said, Pastor, every time you and your wife would make an altar call to pray as families, I would see families praying with their kids. And every time I give my tithes and every time I give my offering, I would say, God, I'm giving, as Pastor says, for the future of my children. They left El Salvador 10, 12 years ago, and for the past 12 years, they have not seen their children. And every time we would give, and every time we would pray, he would pray out to God, and he would give to God and say, God, one day, my children are going to be at this altar, New Life, and I'm going to be holding their hands, and I'm going to be praying with them. Last Sunday was that day. Last Sunday, he was holding hands with his children. Why? Because he believed in the word of God. He believed in the power of prayer, but he also believed in the power of giving. Yes. Last Sunday, at the end of the service, in the evening service, a sister that's been coming to our church, she's been struggling with her marriage. She's been struggling financially. But one day, last year, she gave $1,000 for building for the future. She gave $1,000. Her husband has not been at church for the whole year 2016. 15, 14, he hasn't been back to church. But last year, in November, when I talked about building for the future, and then we were going to give another $1,000, he hasn't been in church for the past 10, almost 5 years. And as they were leaving, her husband told his wife, you know, I haven't been back to church. But I'm going to give next year in 2017 my own $1,000 for that building. So she texts me, see, Pastor, you don't know this, but I was going to give again silently in secret. But my husband just told me that he's going to give $1,000. Now listen, see, you will never outgive God. I said, you will never outgive God. So last Sunday, right there, with tears in her eyes, She began to share with my wife, Sister, I've struggled so many years in this country. But one day I believe what Pastor and you said. And I began to believe God and I began to pray, God, I believe that one day I will make $50,000 a year or more. And with tears in her eyes, she said, Pastor, she told my wife, this year I'm going to start making $50,000 or more. Now, for some of you, that might not mean, but I've seen her struggles. Another sister last year told me, Pastor, they've given me a position in my job. And she says, I've only asked for a small amount. And then she says, they surprised me. This year, I'm going to start making $10,000 more. We have a young family. We have a young family. A week ago, they entered their new constructed home. How is it that someone can go from 1 year to 10,000, another year to 50,000? Is it because they're so special? Is it because they're so faithful? It's the gracie. It's the grace. It's the mercy of God. It's because they believe they shattered, and because they believe God can do for them what they can never do. And when they give out of gratitude. And God will always give back to you more than what you've ever given. See, some of you have tried your way and it has not worked. I tried in my way. I tried to do it my way with my finances. But God, every year, has exceeded anything that I've ever given to Him. As a matter of fact, if you don't want to tithe, we will never force you to tithe to give, because God will never force you. It is out of gratitude. It is of a thankful heart. It is when you believe what God has done and what God is going to do that you give out of a thankful heart. That's why the Bible says that God saw with pleasure the offering of Abel, because Abel offered with faith. So if you're going to give it with faith. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. Don't give out of obligation. Don't give. We will never obligate you. We will never force you, because God never does it. Because when God gives, He always gives it cheerfully to you. And then finally, you have to declare. You have to make declarations of faith. You have to stand up against those walls and say, this is what President Reagan said, Gorbachev, bring down. He made a declaration. Jesus said, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you will tell this mountain, move. And it will move. See, some of us want to have faith like a mountain to tell the mustard seed to move. No, Jesus said, if you have faith like this mustard seed, you will tell those walls, you will tell those limitations, you will tell those things, move in the name of Jesus, move in the name of God, and they will have to move. Now, I don't believe that I have the power to say, move, move. It's not the things that move, it's the things in my mind that begin to move. It's my attitude, my feelings, everything. And when I'm ready, God is ready to do the impossible. Because I will never do, it's not my word, it's the word of God. See, when God promised me something, He will always do it. And when I declare what God says, it will come through. God says in Zechariah, I will make my people strong. That means let the weak say. Let the weak say. If God says He's going to make us strong, He is going to make us strong. And because He said it, I declare it. I can do everything through Christ that strengthens me. God says, I will make my people strong. And in my name, they will advance without fear. And because God said it, I declare it. I, this year, 2017, I'm going to advance without fear. Everything, every fear, everything that has stopped me, the walls are going to come down. The walls are going to come down. I am going to advance. My family is going to advance. Because God is not only the God of Israel, God is my God. And because God helped Israel, He's going to help me. And God says, I promise this will happen. So you got to make declarations of faith. The Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speak. Your mind's got to be renewed by the word of God. You got to have the word of God in your heart, that when you speak, the things will begin to move, because that's how God created everything when He spoke. It is not my tongue that creates things. It is God. But the Bible says that there is life and death in the power of the tongue. I don't have because I've been speaking that I will never have. I will not advance because I've been declaring I will never advance. You've got to declare, this is the year I'm going to advance. This is the year I'm going to get off the base. I'm going to go to second base. This is the year I'm going to grow. This is the year I'm going to be a better worker. I'm going to be a better steward. My family is going to be blessed. New life is going higher. New life is going deeper. What did I do with the vision of the church? We were 15 people, and God says that one day we were going to be 1,270 or more. For the past 20 years, I've been declaring what God says, and it's not because I've said it. It's because God said it. And then you will never advance on your own strength, because the Bible says in Zechariah, it is not by might, it is not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. It is not in you. It is not in me. It is not my might. It is not my power. It is by the power of the Holy Spirit that we advance. So are you ready to advance in 2017? Are you ready to bring down those walls? Are you ready to go farther than you've ever been? Yeah, this is the year we advance. This is the year we go further. This is the year we progress. Hallelujah. Now let me conclude. Let me conclude. You may be seated. Let me conclude by you watching this video of how that wall in Berlin came down. And this morning I prophesy, I declare over you that those walls that have been in your family, in your life, this is the year they're going to come down in the name of Jesus.
This is the story of a wall, the Berlin Wall. It's the story of its construction, of the methods a dictatorship used to keep its citizens trapped inside a kind of prison. It's a story of escape, of ingenuity, courage, and daring, of what people will do in the pursuit of freedom. And it's the story of a profound symbol, the Western gateway to the Cold War. Thousands tried to get over, under, through, or around it, attempting to foil the ever-escalating and perilous wall technology. More than 1,000 died trying.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
It lasted 28 years, and it came down as suddenly as it went up.
The narrator says, it went up and it stood for 28 years. It went up, as it went up suddenly, it came down suddenly. And that's what I declare over you. That every wall that has been in your life, in your marriage, in your finances, in your relationships, suddenly they're going to come down, because God says, I am the God that is going to make you stronger. And this year you will advance without fear, because I am the God of Israel, and this is what I promise. For 28 years, people try to go under the wall. People try to go through the wall. People try to go over the wall. For 28 years, that wall stood in Berlin. But one day a man made a declaration, bring down this wall. I don't know how long ago, my wife told me, stop speaking like that. Change your way of thinking. Because if you don't change your way of thinking, my family, my kids, our marriage, our family will never advance. And not only will my family, but the church will never advance. So I tell you this morning, stop talking like you've talked for the past years. Stop thinking like you thought and start thinking how God thinks about you. Instead of thinking I can't, begin to say I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Instead of saying, we don't have, begin to declare, my God will supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. Instead of saying, I'm going to die, begin to declare, God is my healer. Instead of saying, we will never advance, begin to declare, God has promised that this year we are going to advance. Whatever wall that has been in your mind, whatever wall has been in your life, maybe a year, maybe 28 years, this is the year that wall has to come down in your mind and in your heart. Now, please listen, please listen, please listen. I have my own wall that I had to deal with. God didn't send an angel to demolish those walls. God sent his word. God sent my wife. My wife could not demolish what I needed to demolish. And as much as I love you, I cannot do for you what you're supposed to do. I have my own giants to kill, but we have the same God. I have the same walls that you face, but there's a God that helped me bring down those walls. You hear what I'm saying? This is the truth. God says, I am going to make New Life stronger. And in my name in 2017, they're going to advance without fear because I am God, the God of Israel, and because I promise that this will happen. I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to ask you to stand. This wall is going to come down. And as I'm bringing this wall down, I want you to act in faith and begin to prophesy and begin to declare in my mind, in my life, these walls are going to come. Are you ready to advance this year?
Yes.
I say, are you ready to advance in 2017? Are you ready to bring down those walls that have hindered you, that have stopped you? Remember, the wall only comes down with the word of God. And God says, my word is like a hammer that will break every rock. Not only do I need the word of God, I need to pray and believe that that wall is going to come down. I have to give. I have to believe with the power of the Holy Spirit. Every wall, every stronghold, every spirit of condemnation, every spirit, I don't think so, I don't believe so, God says we can do it, and we're going to do it this year in the name of Jesus. So when I bring down that wall, when I bring down that wall, this is what you got to do. You got to get out of your place. As a step of faith, that this year you want to advance like never before. And you're going to come to this altar and you say, God, God, do for me and for my family what we have never been able to do. God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, take us further than we've gone. Break down everything that has hindered me, because you're the God of the impossible. Are you ready? Father, in the name of Jesus, this wall and the walls in your mind and your heart, they're going to come down in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, they have to come down. They're going to come down. This is the year we are going to advance.